Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resonance Arcade. It is Wednesday night, and we are live.
Wednesday night.
It's Wednesday night. It is Wednesday night.
Yeah, but good afternoon. It's Wednesday night.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show. We are four guys, and there is actually four of us today, for once, from the north of England, and we talk about games for a couple of hours with various different tones and facial expressions that we just freeze in because we've got loads of technical issues going on again, or everyone's internet is shagged.
Every now and again, Steve provides the best facial pause expressions.
I don't know. Sam's then was pretty good. He was paused like that. Brilliant. Anyway, so first of all, we usually talk about the games that we've played this week, and yep. I think we've all played one game, and we've all played the same game.
Minecraft.
Yes, because it's still 1991 or whatever day it is.
I was going to say Minesweep, but then I forgot what sweep was.
But it's The Witcher, obviously. I was going to see how long we could get through the show without talking about The Witcher, but there's pretty much no chance of that now, is there?
Well, we've all got something to talk about for it, haven't we?
Why do I look like I'm looking off in the distance? It's
that thousand-yard stare that you've got from playing The Witcher too much.
Yeah.
That'll do. That's better. Kind of. I'm at a wonk now. I'll just have to stare like that for the entire show.
The stare of a man who's killed 1,000 drowners.
Yes, way too many drowners. I think I might be starting to run thin on enemies now to kill in it, like new enemies, because that was one of the things I said last week, that there's a new enemy every 5 seconds, there's something new, and they're all slightly different, and it's wonderful. I love it. So, Lou.
Yes?
You've played it, actually, now, haven't you?
I've played it. I've put about 7.5-8 hours into it.
Oh, so you've only done about an hour since last time we spoke.
I've got up to when you meet the first... the first guy from the Wild Hunt down in the caves.
All right, okay.
And I'm stuck on him.
With Kira?
It's really hard. I'm sure I'm doing something wrong because I always have no health and I don't do any damage to him.
Are you using your signs and your potions parrying, and dodging?
I don't think you can block that guy. One hits you.
Well, you don't have to block him. You can dodge him and parry him. Do you know what? You know what actually happened with me in that fight? I actually didn't find him too hard, but one time, Kira blew him into the wall, and he got stuck behind some staggletites and staggermites.
Staggletites. That's what they are.
Staggletites and staggermites.
Stalagmites and stalactites.
Oh, whatever. Yeah. Stalagmites, stalactites, whatever. Whatever, right? He got stuck behind some of them, and he was stuck there for the entire thing, so I just kept signing him and cutting him up and then running off. So I got through that one pretty quick. But I didn't find him difficult before that, really.
All my fights difficult. Every single one.
Oh, they are. Even when you get good at it, they're still difficult, and I think that's a good thing, I have to be honest.
But are you using potions, signs?
I'm trying to. I mean, I'm mainly using food to try and get my health up, but I just run out of food.
No. Swallow.
I'm using swallow, but it doesn't do that. It doesn't like increase it that much. I've only got 3 swallow potions as well.
Yeah,
If you use swallow, if you get hit, then it stops the regeneration. So if you use swallow, you've got to evade. Yeah. For 30 seconds until it builds your health up properly.
I've now got a potion.
Plus, if you use Ard. Oh, sorry, Yen.
Is it? Yerden. Which one is it?
The shield.
Quen.
Quen.
Use Quen, then it'll stop you from taking a hit.
Or more hits if you've upgraded that particular tree. I respect my character recently, so I've now got everything in the potions and oils tree, and I'm nails. Basically, everything slows down whenever I'm just about to take a hit, so I've got enough chance to dodge anyway. But I'm really big on the potions in this game, and I don't normally in these kind of games. I don't usually bother with them.
No, The Witcher you kind of have to though. Potions are a major part of being a Witcher.
Yeah, and they make it that way as well, and it's really really well balanced, I think.
As long as you have plenty of alcohol on you though, don't worry about running out.
Yeah, I keep buying loads of Alka-Hest. Like I've got 50 or something in my inventory, weighing me down.
I've started to sell them. I've got that bloody many of them now. I don't buy them either.
It's probably where I'm going wrong now. I just feel like a lot of the time I'm running around with about 20% health and I'm eating bread and drinking water and it's going up by a tiny amount. I've got to basically eat a banquet worth of food in order to fill my health bar. And then somebody comes across and whacks me and knocks half my health off in one hit.
There's an upgrade. Mm. Oh, God. Screensaver. God damn it. There's an upgrade you can get in the end mutagen tree, which allows you, whenever it's daytime, it will increase your, it will automatically increase your vitality.
I've got that one.
Yeah, I've got that one.
Yeah, Sun and Stars.
But there's also loads of other upgrades. Like, I've got one, for example, that is now, was it Golden Aureoli or something like that? Aureolus, something, whatever it is. That's basically, if I fight an enemy that poisons me, the poison now gives me health back. There's loads of little things like that across it. And I've got like the third enhancement to Swallow now as well. Superior Swallow, I think. So I've got 5 Swallow potions.
Can you guys remember what level you were when you fought that guy?
Not very high.
Level 6.
I'm level 3, so I think that's why I'm struggling.
Yeah,
I was side quests.
Tried to do a lot.
It's got a recommended level next to the quest in your journal. He should be somewhere near that.
Has he got like a red skull above him when you fight him?
I don't think so, but I haven't really noticed any of the indicators when I'm attacking enemies anyway.
Are you even playing that game?
I don't know. Like I said, I know I'm doing something wrong, but I'm finding it really hard to
grasp the
mechanics.
What makes that guy difficult? Go on, sorry.
I was just going to say, the one thing I find difficult about that particular fight was not fighting him himself. It's the fact that after you've taken a certain amount of damage, he goes into an invincible sphere and then spawns some little dickhead enemies you've got to fight. That's what makes the fight difficult. He himself is not too bad. I just kept stunning him and then using triangle on his back and then running away a bit.
Also, as well, when you're fighting his little minions, the Wild Hunt, what they call, demon, Wild Hunt,
the little hounds, thingies, whatever they are. Yeah.
When you fight them, I think if you use an Elementia potion, elemental oil,
yeah.
You use Quen as much as you can, obviously. But I think also if you use Igni with the fire Igni's one, that's a good on them ones. But that's a good thing about it. Every single different enemy has a different combination of things that you can use on it. Everything tends to work on everything. Like if you use Yerdan everywhere, usually things slow down when they come within the Yerdan circle, but that's really handy. Like for certain enemies, like the ogre that I fought the other day, Yerdan's really handy because even though he's big and lumbering, he tends to do 2 hits when he swings at you, and you can dodge out of the way of them both if you use Yerdan, but you can't really do it otherwise.
I have found Yerdan is indispensable for dealing with wraiths and ghosts because a lot of the wraiths have poison effects on you. Yeah, you have to use it. Like, I didn't like that sign at first, but I've actually become one of my favourites now. I use it all the time.
I didn't like any of the signs apart from Igni. I just wanted to use Igni on everything, but I realised you can't at all.
I felt like I didn't want to use anything more complicated than a direct damage spell.
Yeah, there's basically the premise is, if it's anything like a necrophage or anything that's ice-based, use Igni. If it's anything that flies, use Ard, because that gets them out. Or use your crossbow. You can use a combination of both.
If there's a pack of anything, use Axie, because you could normally take over one of them and then they'll all start harassing that, which gives you a bit of chance to...
Oh, I haven't upgraded my Axie, so I've only got the simple Axie, so it just basically stuns them.
And Quen, that's just a shield, but the more you build it up, it actually gets to the point where when they hit you, it impacts them and knocks them back as well.
Yeah,
which is what happens with that boss if you try and hit him, because I actually died just by running into him one time.
Oh, I've got a big protective shield on me. Let's run into it.
Well, no, I did it by accident because of the controls. Because another problem I'm having is the third-person perspective. It doesn't really work for me. I'm finding it very difficult to control as well. And so I'm kind of running around randomly and crashing the shields, which kill me because I've got 1 health.
Are you playing with the original key setup, or have you managed to rebind
it? I've managed to rebind it through a few mods and stuff.
So have you got... dodge and evade both bounces.
Yeah, I did, but I wasn't rolling until I got to the golem. I forgot about roll because I only had to dodge until then, but the golem runs at you and kills you in 1 hit, so I suddenly realized I could roll out the way of things as well.
You've got your target set as well, because your target comes in quite handy.
Yeah, yeah, I've got all the keys bound, you and it does come in handy. Like, you know, in the fight where you've got all of the hounds coming in, you're inside the shield.
Yeah.
It helps to target them there, because you're not running out of the shield, lunging at things and freezing to death.
I found it more organic not using that, because I can basically, depending on what direction you're facing, you can, you know, fight someone that way and then face the other direction and stab someone up the other way. Yeah, I found it better without it, personally.
I have to say...
If you're going to use Axie, then you need to be able to target a specific character.
Well, I tend to just aim at them. I just start aim at them with the mouse, and I tend to hit what I want to hit.
Chris is pro as fuck at this. That's what he's saying.
I was watching someone on YouTube. Literally today, I got stuck on a quest, or the quest was bugged, rather. I got into a village, and there should have been a guy there to tell me to move to the next area. Killed all the guys in the village, and the quest, I couldn't find anyone. I spent about an hour walking around this village trying to find... Anyway, I looked on YouTube to see what the quest did, and I just went to the next area, and the guy I needed to speak to was there. Instead of me just being told that to go to him, you know, so the quest marker hadn't updated. But anyway, I found him. Forgot what the point was.
Talking about being pro as fuck.
Oh yeah, that was it. Watching this guy on YouTube, and I was like, what the fuck is he doing? He's got no fucking idea what he's doing. He's just literally not dodging at all. He's just fighting humans, and he's just hitting them with his sword constantly. And it's like, mate, dodge behind them and stab them up from behind. Use hard. Yeah. Do something.
Parry.
Things like when they go to strike you, if you use parry, then attack straight away, you can knock a massive amount of health off them in one go.
Yeah.
Plus, if you've been maintaining your weapons and your armor.
Yes.
I've got the second set of Griffin armor. I've went on the upgrade quest. I'm just about to go on the third upgrade quest, actually, for it.
The
Griffin armor's pretty good. I'm starting to look at the... I've got the cat armor, the first set. I built it and I didn't like it, so I'm going to see what it's like, but...
I've still got the starting silver sword, and it's down to like 40%. It broke. It's on the way to breaking in this boss fight, and there's no way for me to repair it during the mission. So I'm stuck with that as well.
Now I've got to a point where I've got loads of recipes, so I can actually build repair kits and other stuff. But I don't really need any, because I've got so many. I've got like 50 master ones. It's ridiculous the amount of shit I've got. I'm one of them who goes around a level. I've got 10,000 gold as well. I'm one of those who runs around a level and picks everything up. Goes back to, you know, I did it in Skyrim, goes back to a merchant, sells it. It goes to all the different merchants in this game, because you can't really hack it by waiting around. Or you probably could, but I don't know. I just don't feel like I want to in this game. I love this game. It's the best thing that's ever happened to me in terms of games.
Two questions. How good are you with Gwent?
I'm really getting quite good at that.
I've got a few full decks of cards now, and
I've got three full decks now. I've got Skortel. I haven't got monsters yet. I'm nearly there, though. I'm getting there with that. Skortel, Nilfgaardian Empire, and Northern deck is amazing. And I can even when I get a really shit draw from my deck, I can beat people usually, unless it's a special, you know, hard player. I've won all of the cards that I need to win so far. I think I missed one out in one of the first missions, like from the very first innkeeper, because I was a little bit... We said this last week. The first week, I was a little bit like, not going to bother with Gwent. It's shit as. But I got into it, and I want them to release it separately.
As a card game.
Well, yeah, that as well. I'd love to play it with people. I'd love to sit down with you guys and...
I thought that as well, that the fact that you're playing against an enemy AI, you sort of like, I'd actually quite like to play it against other humans. That would be really cool. That is one online thing. If they put that into the game, I'd be like, I don't need any multiplayer, just let me play against other people online. That would be quite nice.
I'm going to put down my spy card, my Sigmund Dirkster, 4 points on your side, and I'm going to draw two cards. There's loads of little cool tactics you can use to and to be fair, the AI, playing the AI has taught me loads of cool tactics. Some of the AI players are quite devious, in fact, some of the way that they play. Brilliant. There's nothing about I didn't for a while, and that's why I was like, I'm not bothering with this shit.
It is quite a steep learning curve with Gwent.
Can I also give you a bit of advice? Anytime you go to an innkeeper or a merchant who's selling Gwent cards, buy them all. Just buy them.
Spend as much money as you can afford on them.
Yeah, and they're not even that expensive. Most of the ones I've come across to buy are like 20, 30 gold.
There's another hint for making gold as well. Not just buying, collecting everything and selling it to all the merchants. Make sure you find the right merchants. If you go to, you know, your hunter trophies. You know, when you try and sell them, you get like 20 gold for them or something. But if you take them to a herbalist or whatever, he's a herbalist or an apothecary or something. But he's in the
Capella.
No, no, not him. Northeast of Nilfgaard, there's one set of huts, and then above it, about, I don't know, 20-100 yards, there's another set. There's another hut, and there's a like a secret mage in there. And if you go in there and sell your things to him, you get like 200-300 gold for your potions. But on top of that, sell all of your armor to armorers, and then sell all of your swords and weapons, even if they're shit weapons, sell them all to blacksmiths, and sell all your books to book merchants. Even though it's only a couple of gold, it adds up over the time, and that's why I've got 10 grand gold now. I'm not even being that right. One of the news items that I was going to move on to later was the new patch that they brought out. I wasn't aware of this, but there was a bug in the game, or there was an exploit in the game that would allow you to basically kill a load of cows, loot the hides, and then go and sell the hides for a lot of money, right? There's always that kind of thing in an RPG of some sort. But yeah, what they've done in this game, and this is why CD Projekt Red are one of the best developers I've ever come across in my life. Not just have they made a brilliant game, they really support the community and really kind of have a bit of fun with the community as well. What they've done to get around that, instead of nerfing it and basically saying cow hides are now worth one gold, what they've done is they've put in this, what's it called? The Bovine Defense Force Initiative, right? And if you do that, if you kill all the cows and then rest, and in order for the cows to respawn, when you wake back up, they'll send in this ridiculously high level monster that to basically destroy you, and it's just a big massive cow, like a demon cow, and it's brilliant. I haven't actually tried it in the game, but I've seen a YouTube video of it. It's like it's the best thing ever. I think that
I might do that just to do that. Just to have that happen. That'd be quite good fun.
You can kill him. You can kill it, but I mean, it's a ridiculously high level, so it's a case of you know one hit, you're dead. Unless you get to a certain point, and then, but by that point, you're gonna have so much gold that you don't need to kill the cows. So it's, you know, that's I think that's a brilliant little way of them going, all right, gamers, here you go. Here's some taste of your own medicine. I like that. I really like that.
So, what do you think about the aesthetics of the game?
I think they are wonderful.
Yeah,
it's beautiful.
My favorite thing is still the way that the trees move in the wind. It's fucking brilliant.
One of the things that I like is if you use Ard when you're on the water surface, it all ripples away from you.
I've never tried that. That's cool.
It's like really cool water effect in it.
If you cast Igni on anything, it all has a slight kind of tessellation on it with all the crackling and nice looks.
I still don't think it looks as good as Skyrim. I think the world looks a bit bland. It's all yellow and sort of
the characters look miles better than anything in Skyrim.
No, this game looks definitely better.
Are you playing on a Vindu 2, Lou?
Great.
No, I'm playing on a really good game, Rick. But it's not so much that the graphical effects and quality are really good, but the world itself is a bit samey, boring.
The world feels inviting and feels like I want to, not just the look I'm talking about here, it feels like I want to travel everywhere on horseback, or I want to run everywhere, because everything feels unique. There doesn't really, I mean, there obviously is repeated prefabs, but nothing feels like it's in your face repeated, apart from, as I said last week, the characters.
How far have you actually traveled, Lou?
Well, I'm at that boss, which is I'm the second area, and
Went around Moochin, or you just went from mission to mission?
I went around Moochin, but a lot of the time I've just been going to missions, because the world doesn't... With Skyrim, as you travel, you find places that you go past, you think, oh, I want to stop here and check this out. Whereas in Witcher, I'm just basically riding through tracks and woods, and there's not a lot on the way.
Yeah, but that's because you're sticking to the track. Goes the eagle flies. And you'll come
and my
across.
Horse flies off a cliff, which is what happened one time. It ran up to the edge of a cliff, stopped, but then fell off the cliff.
I've had that once or twice, actually. You caught the edge of something small, it falls off, and then its legs do that. It just like hovers on the ground for a little bit. It doesn't die. I've never seen it die yet.
No, it didn't die, but I just fell off a cliff and was stuck down there.
So do you know the thing about when you get the horse to gallop, if you just let go of everything apart and you gallop on the horse, it'll automatically follow the path?
Yeah, and it doesn't use any stamina, even though it's galloping. Is quite handy.
Yeah.
What does it not? I didn't know that.
It uses stamina when I do it.
it does it when I do it as well. Talking about this stuff, the horse fall off a cliff, one thing I will say is a bit weak about Geralt is the fact that if he drops down like a 8-foot drop that I in real life could do without getting hurt, he dies or loses half his health, and you're like, yeah, what? None of your mutations, your cat mutations, make you drop down a bit more than your own height, mate.
All cat does is affect his irises, though, that's the thing. Oh, no, actually,
he's
no.
He's got general mutations, hasn't he, to make him superior bloke. Like...
Yeah.
Are witches sort of stronger in all this kind of stuff than normal men, all that kind of shit, aren't they?
Yeah, they're better. They're more skilled anyway, I think.
They might be heavier, though, because they're really hard and muscly. They might be heavier, so when they fall...
It's all of them. Yeah, it's all that scar tissue. It's weighing him down.
Yeah, Geralt actually weighs 26 stone.
So the scale of it as well.
Oh man, I've just got a Skellige, and it's almost if not bigger than Nilfgaard and that, you know, the whole Vismar area.
I mean, I haven't managed to explore the whole map yet, but from what I've read, you've got Skyrim, which is 15 square miles. Red Dead Redemption, which is 28 square miles.
Is it really?
GTA 5, which is 49 square miles. Then you've got The Witcher, which is 51 square miles.
Wow.
See, now I've got to kind of say something about this. The size really doesn't matter here, and I know that's a cliche, but it really doesn't. It's the quality and the content of the world in my eyes.
Mm. Yeah, but it's got a lot of good content as well. So the more area you've got, the more content they can fit in.
100% agree. This is one of the best RPGs I've played in my life. It really is. It's really well done, and there's a lot of love that's went into it. Not just I can pick holes in it all day as well if I wanted to. But I haven't played a game that's made me want. I was up till 1 o'clock last night playing it again. I've been up till 4 o'clock most weekends playing it. My wife's going to divorce me. I'm playing it that much, you know. I'm absolutely enamoured with everything about this.
I think you're going to get more point low when it's just going to click.
Probably, but I need to put the difficulty down to the lowest because I'm playing it on Blood and Bones or whatever it is, and it's too hard. Every boss fight.
But it was for me, and now it's right because I've learned.
I want to learn in a way that I'm not going to get frustrated by it because I literally turned it off in rage the last time I played it because I couldn't. I died about 15 times with this boss.
Are you dodging? Are you using dodging?
I'm dodging, but I've got this much health left. I've got no potions and no health.
Look, I've done some ridiculously hard fights just by being good at fighting.
I know,
like,
but
getting good at it.
Steel attests to this. When I play certain games for the first time, like it's a new type of game for me, I'm really bad at them. And I'm really bad because I'm trying to play them in a way that isn't the way you're meant to play the game.
Yeah.
I'm trying to play this like Skyrim. I'm trying to steam through this. You can't stealth in this game at all.
No.
Which is a big problem for me because I like to...
Well, so do I. I love stealth. Some of my favourite games on the planet, and every time I play Skyrim, I stealth through it.
Yeah,
but I'm playing this as The Witcher.
But I'm not. I'm trying to play this like a game that I've played before, and until that clicks, it's going to be really frustrating for me. Until I can work out how to play this game and realise that it's not like other games that I've played, because it's not. I don't play third-person games very often at all, because I really struggle to get into them.
I think what you'll need to do, Lou, is revert back to a previous save.
Probably do.
I'm really stuck
at the moment. I'm really, really stuck. And I don't want to go back to outside the cave either because it's going to take ages.
Cave that you're in, I think you can... If you go to a safe place, if you've got alcohol on you, just meditate. It'll refresh your swallow stocks and just use your swallow.
I can't do that because I'm actually in the boss fight.
If you go back out just before the boss fight, because there's autosaves before every major event. I tend to quick save like a whore in this game, like a lot.
I do it. I've started.
It doesn't let you a lot of the time, though, does it? When you're in like imminent peril, it won't let you save.
But yeah, if you're in a battle situation, it won't let you save. But I'm saving as soon as I see an enemy, save. Yeah. Immediately, like, because it's not that I think I'm going to die necessarily. I mean, I have died a lot. Early on when I first started playing it, like you, it was really, really difficult when I first started playing it. Now, it is as difficult. If I am not paying attention when I get accosted by 6 wolves, and even though I'm level 15 and they hardly take any health off me, if all 6 of those wolves start attacking me and I don't dodge and I don't treat it like a serious fight, I get fucked and I'm dead almost instantly. That's how hard this how good... It's like Batman. You haven't played Batman, though, have you?
I don't play third-person games, usually.
That Batman, the Batman game where you've got the Arkham Knight, Arkham Asylum, all them Gotham Knight thing, whatever. All of those games, they've got a really good but difficult fighting mechanic. Once you get into the flow of things and once you understand how it works, I mean, I'm not particularly great at like getting combos going in that game, but I'm good enough to get by, if you know what I mean. Mm. Well, this isn't about combos, but it's about timing things right and understanding.
It's about using everything at your disposal, and that's something that I'm really struggling with, is to know the right things to use at the right time, because I'm just trying to basically light attack things to death.
Beastery. You press right B on your keyboard is your beastery.
I know that, but it only tells you the stuff after you've encountered the enemy, and the enemy I'm stuck on at the moment is one that isn't in the beastery.
Yeah, well, to be fair, bosses you don't tend to get.
Yeah.
I think, in fact, the beastry entry, once you've killed that boss, doesn't have any kind of, this is how you kill him, because you've already killed him and you don't have to kill him again.
Just revert back to an earlier save and build yourself up.
Yeah, I think I'll probably come into this place a bit too early, because level 3 doesn't seem to be high enough level to attack this guy.
Well, low. But yeah, I would say, because when you, I think on a lesser difficulty, you can meditate and that will, your health will regenerate. You can't do that, but if you've got alcohol supplies, so Dwarven Spirit, Alkahest.
I've got a lot of that.
If you meditate, even for an hour, which is the shortest time you can, it will refresh all your potions using alcohol.
I didn't know.
And then you basically take Swallow so your health is full, then meditate again so you've then got 3. Go into the fight with 3 Swallow with it equipped. When he hits you a couple of times, take it and just dodge and evade until your health goes back up and you'll beat him.
And also pay attention to, and use a Thunderbolt. You'll have a Thunderbolt by now as well.
Yeah,
so when you,
I had 3 of them.
Thunderbolt you only have for 30 seconds to start off with. So whenever you're going to use it, make sure you use it and then hit him as much as you can. And then make sure you monitor all of your buffs that are going on and you know what's going on. I know there's a lot on the screen, but if those buffs make a difference to how the fight goes as well. Because I mean, if you've got, I've got loads of them now. I've got stamina boosters. I've got poison, like immunity.
It sounds like a hell of a lot, but if you go out into the world and start doing little quests, it kind of gets you used to it stage by stage as you get introduced to new powers and new alchemy and oils and all that type of stuff.
I never thought I'd say this, but I almost resent the fact that you get so much right from the beginning, like all 5 of you.
You hypocrite.
I know, I'm one of the first people to say I hate tutorials and games, but I actually feel like there was so much new things for someone who's never played a game like this before to take in that it was really, really difficult. It still is.
I agree.
CD Projekt actually came out and said that the main driver for making this game was for the fans of the series.
Mm.
So
you know what? I want to go
kind
back
of expect you to have a bit of a prior knowledge about it.
I want to go back and play 2 now. I've also like been reading synopsises of the whole like story arc so far, because I don't want to play 1 because I got sick of it. I got sick of the mechanics and the general feel. Although I didn't really get that into it either, but I want to play 2 because I believe that was a lot better than 1 in general.
I think The Witcher 2 is supposed to be really good. I don't think it's on any Sony consoles, and I obviously don't have a PC powerful enough to play it.
It's a
shame.
So have we done enough Witcher spoofing, or should we continue?
Because I know I've got it in the news section, but I wanted to mention the development costs.
Okay, well we'll talk about that when we get to the news section. In fact, we're probably going to move on to that immediately because we haven't played any other games, have we?
No.
This is how sad it is.
I'm just going to be back in one moment. I'll just be a second.
All right. Or should we do it? Actually, let's do our list section first. Have we got any lists? Oh, sorry, the Way of the Exploding List.
They didn't join in, Chris.
Sam missed it, and Steve was just sat there going, what?
the list thing.
Yeah.
Just a delayed reaction.
Delayed.
Takes a bit of time to get over here.
Sorry, can you excuse me for
one? Has anybody got one, or has anybody in the chat got one?
How unprofessional. I'm unprofessional. I've got a few.
I've got one in mind. I don't know if we've talked about this before, but I've got one.
Go on, because mine are crap.
Mine was going to be, it's not a list as such, it's kind of, well, you can talk about several, but what if a gaming world like a actually existed, which one would you actually maybe want to live in if you could, like as in to actually live there as a person?
For what reasons? Could we have special skills and things like that if we were living in these worlds? For example,
I would say, yeah, surely.
If the world had magic, then you would be able to learn magic.
Yeah, I would say.
Well, not necessarily, because it depends on some of the worlds. Only certain people who are born with magic powers can be magicians.
So you have to choose your worlds very carefully.
So
I was going to say, if you go to like Star Wars, not everyone's born with a strong Force connection. So yeah, you might be like, oh, I'll go to the Star Wars world if I could be a Jedi. Sort of caveat. That's up to you.
It's tricky. Right. Well, a Deus Ex, but that's only because it's the real world with all the conspiracy theories kind of unraveled in front of you. All the conspiracy theories from every walk of life, pretty much. Well, American culture, at least. And you've got augmentations. You can have... But only J.C. Denton has augmentations in that, so...
Yeah, loads of people have got augmentations in Deus Ex.
Oh, actually, yeah, some of the enemies do as well, don't they?
Is this the original?
Yeah.
Yes, the what's his name? The German guy.
Hans.
Is it Hans?
Hans Summit, probably.
But he's got an older generation. Both him and Anna De Vara both have like old style augmentations, don't they? And your JC has a new style ones, and they all kind of don't like him because they're all hidden.
Ah, right. What the list is at that I proposed was of the fictional gaming worlds. If you could like live in one or inhabit one yourself, which one is your favourite to live in as you? No, not as you, but say if you wanted to be the hero or whatever, like if you want to actually live there.
I think I like the idea of No Man's Sky as a world concept. I haven't played the game yet, obviously, so I don't know if it's going to be any good. But I like the idea of the multiple planets, many infinite planets almost. And
but isn't that the universe we live in?
What, but with the access to them as well, I'm talking about.
Right, okay.
So that gives you...
I thought you would have chosen like Terraria or something, Chris.
Well, no, because I'd be limited. Too deep. Yeah, I'd be in limited to two dimensions then, wouldn't I?
I know, but just think of how much you could dig.
And plus I'd have to fight a big fish called Duke Fishtron, which is rubbish.
I'm sure I've thought of this before, and I quite like the idea of Sonic's world. I like how good-looking the zones are in Sonic.
Well, the problem with Sonic is that they've their own... I don't know what mythology is the right way, but their own story has been changed so much that it's not even... The Sonic games that are out now are not... It's not even in the same world as Sonic 1.
No, the originals were set on the planet Mobius.
Mobius. And Robotnik, he was called Robotnik, was the only human there.
Yeah.
And all the other animals were like anthropomorphic animals. He was the only human man there. I think there was some idea that he was like not from that planet or something. But it's not like that at all now. It's all just whatever.
I didn't even know Sonic had a story, I have to be honest with you. I just thought he
was all become... very much Dragon Ball Z rip-off, which if you're going to rip something off, is not a particularly good narrative to rip off.
But they kind of went there with Hypersonic, didn't they, really?
Yeah, that's a rip-off of Super Saiyan. It's all, like, DBZ.
Sonic's level is 9,000!
Well, Shadow the Hedgehog's like that kind of thing as well, and he's just a douche.
He is a douche.
Quite like the idea of Tamriel from The Elder Scrolls. So I thought that was quite an inviting and interesting world. And the whole of the cultures and the history and all that, and the powers you can have, and just the fact that certain places in it are genuinely nice.
The world from World of Warcraft as well. I grabbed a beta of World of Warcraft before it came out, and it didn't have any enemies in it. You could just stroll around. It was at some LAN. You could just stroll around the world, and the world is beautiful. And it's got this kind of video game kind of world in that every area is very distinct. No, every area is distinct. Like, In real worlds, and even stuff like Skyrim and Oblivion and stuff like that, the worlds are quite continuous. They're like, they're kind of roughly one biome, if you will.
Hmm.
Whereas the older games like World of Warcraft and EverQuest, they'd be very distinct zones, and I love that. I love the idea that you can go around this world and everywhere is slightly different, has a different feel and a different colour scheme and different trees and... You know, you get like ice zones and underwater zones. It's almost like the Star Wars universe. And let's see how many different biomes we can use to represent planets.
But one of the thing with Star Wars is that every planet is like, that's a jungle planet, that's a nice planet, that's a desert planet. No variation whatsoever when you're on the planet.
No, there isn't. But I kind of like that, and it works very, very well for fiction, because you kind of want to think of it like that. You want to think of, I'm in a jungle now, and I'll walk from a jungle into a desert, and from a desert into an icy area or something like that. In gaming, that's what you want. I had the most fun in terms of world exploration, going around stuff like World of Warcraft and EverQuest, just because you're never quite sure what's coming next.
See, I quite enjoyed Skyrim for that, though, in general. I mean, in fact, all of the Elder Scrolls games I've enjoyed for that. The fact that you go up a mountain and it starts getting snowier as you go up the mountain. You know, you go into a Dwemer cavern and it's full of Dwemer artifacts and... You know,
it does, but it's still kind of predictable, though, whereas with stuff like World of Warcraft, you're never quite sure what you're going to get. It's not always entirely logical. You'll go through a cave and come out into a lava zone.
Yeah, I suppose it's total fantasy, isn't it? Whereas I suppose Skyrim is at least slightly based on reality and themes. Each area, that's a Nordic area, that area is an elven area, that kind of thing. Is it Mytholoin Chats just said, Minecraft would be interesting, quite lonely, though. Depends on how many creepers are around.
Yeah, I was gonna say, if you get, as long as you get your shelter built, then...
as long as you're punching up trees.
Yeah. I can't think of any other.
Really am stuck on this.
Yeah, it's a weird. I just thought it was an interesting one, but it's quite difficult to say because most of the time in games, there's usually like a great problem or an adversary to overcome. So if you say, "Oh, let's go like Resident Evil world," when you're going to be getting killed by zombies, aren't you? So it's
farming simulator. It's like,
let's go to Half-Life area or something. You're just going to get a head crab sucked to your
face. Let's go to Mario world where absolutely nothing is based on any sense of logic and you basically whatsoever.
You have to nut everything or jump on everything. One of the two.
Yeah.
I just had an idea there, and I've completely lost it. But the Halo.
I thought Halo, then just going to get knacked by the Covenant.
Well, imagine the Covenant aren't there. I mean, I think there are lots of Halos anyway, but I love the...
imagine the Covenant aren't there.
Well, okay.
Imagine there's no such thing as Master Chief in Halo
universe. I love the Halo world. I love the fact that it kind of resembles a sort of Alpine area, and it's the idea that you see the world stretching off up past the horizon is pretty cool.
Ooh,
I really like that.
What about Mass Effect?
So the Covenant aren't there, but the Flood are.
Oh.
Yeah, Mass Effect. Well, yeah, that's one. Mass Effect's world without the Reapers, with no Reapers. What a great world! That'd be awesome. That is cool. Good pick there. I can't even think of that one.
Again, Dragon Age as well. I mean, I know you probably haven't played that, Sam, but it's a wonderful RPG world, and I thoroughly enjoyed running around that.
Space Hulk without the Gene Stealers. Wolfenstein without the Nazis.
Quake 2 without the Strog.
Hey, I did walk around some of the Quake 2 levels. I always loved the idea of going to a real...
No, you try and jump off the edge or something and break both your legs.
I've always thought about that. I'd like to walk around the edge, but then I'd actually be terrified walking around the edge because it's so bloody high.
Yeah, well, no, that's the thing. Have you not walked around the edge with your VR headset on?
I have, yeah, and it's pretty cool, actually.
It's weird, though, isn't it?
It is, but that is actually really cool. The VR is actually quite a good way to experience some of these worlds.
I found a good... I was on the toilet the other day, and they're talking about... the other day, just that day. And they're talking about Morpheus in there, obviously, Project Morpheus and PS4.
In your toilet?
In PlayStation Magazine. That's where I read my PlayStation Magazine, in the toilet. Right, so they're talking about Morpheus, and there's obviously some flagship games that they're bringing out with it, and there's one called... something to do with bombs. What's it called? Keep Talking or Everyone Explodes, it's called.
Right.
Sounds like a prog rock band name, for God's sake. But anyway, basically, it's this I think you'll like. It's a clever use of VR, and I like the idea of it. One guy sits in a room with a headset on, with his VR headset, and he's got his two motion sensors, and he can move a bomb around and look around on this bomb thing. And this bomb basically has modules on it, and you have to decode and decipher the modules in order to disable the bomb. There's different difficulty settings, there's different speeds, there's different amounts of times you can fail before the bomb explodes. But the premise is that the real world, there's one or two or however many people with an actual physical manual that have all of the instructions on how to decode the bomb in it. Mm. And it's a party game, but it sounds really, really cool. It sounds awesome, in fact. It sounds like it'd be a lot of fun to do.
Sounds very similar to Space Team, if you ever saw that.
Not familiar, no.
So Space Team is an app on your phone, and you basically all have the app, and it's full of knobs and levers and buttons, all with ridiculous names. And you all be given a task, like to basically press buttons or dial knobs or something, but you've got to read them out. So you've got to say, like, you know... turn the Geiger power plant to 15% or something, and it's like your spaceship is heading towards a star, it's about to explode.
Right.
It's really frantic, and everyone's got to tell each other what to do.
Well, yeah, sounds like very, very similar concept to that. But this was a nice way of getting... One of the problems with VR, and we've experienced this firsthand, one person will be sat there playing a game and going, oh, this is amazing. Oh, my God, this is brilliant. Oh, oh, what, you know, and everyone else in the room will be sat there waiting for them to finish.
Mm.
That is the basic premise of VR, isn't it?
And that's why AR is going to be better.
I'm with you, Steve. I'm with you.
Why would AR be better in that sense? Because that just means that the person viewing the amazing world can see the people behind.
That also means that the other people that are also wearing headsets can see the exact same thing that they're seeing.
Well, from a different perspective, though.
From a different perspective.
Well, you can do that if you're wearing a VR headset. Yeah, if everyone wears a VR headset, the only reason...
No, but you can't see them, then.
You can if they're avatar. The world.
No, you can see an avatar, you can't see them.
But you're still going to walk into walls and stuff with VR headsets on.
Yeah.
With AR, you've got actual reality in front of you as well.
Well, Vive is taking steps for that because Vive is a stand-up experience. It has room mapping, so it shapes the world so that it tells you when you walk up to a wall. All
right, you are about to walk into.
Well, no, it shows you a grid showing the actual overlay of the real room that you're in on top of the world that you're in. So as you walk towards a wall, suddenly a grid starts to appear, and you realise, shit, I'm near a wall.
Yeah, but. Then what if the thing you want to get to is like 5 foot beyond the wall?
Well, that's up to the game designer, isn't it, to make sure that the world.
Yeah, fits the game designer doesn't know the shape of your room.
It does, but the actual device does, and so the game designer has to put some kind of procedural generation.
Make every possible configuration of room.
No, you procedurally generate it. You procedurally generate it.
Or you just use AR,
which is the same thing.
It's the same thing. You're still stuck in the same small room.
It's exactly the same, but I think Steve's point... Steve's main arguing point here is that in AR, you don't have to render somebody else. You can see them in reality, and you can see the rest of the room in reality. You don't have to procedurally render it. You just have to procedurally say, you can't go past this extent. That's
but you also lose the immersion because you're in your room.
I don't think so.
If you're wearing an AR headset, right, and you're... Let's say we're all around your house.
Right, do we have to go lose?
Well, let's say we're all on Chris's house or Sam's house or someone's house and we're all wearing AR headsets and we decide to play, I always go to this because it's the easiest way to describe it, like a zombie game. So we're there and all of a sudden the windows, the doors are all entry points for these zombies. So you're actually in your house and you're trying to defend your house against this incoming intruder. You've got something representing a gun in your hand. I think that is so much more appealing.
That could be proper nightmare fuel, though. If it's actually house, you're like, zombies actually came through that door the other day, and I'm now having nightmares about it.
For God's sake, I could watch a film with someone. I was watching Dark Skies the other day. It's not a particularly great film. It was on TV. And I had a few little, you know, twinges when I was in bed thinking, oh, aliens are going to come and get me. You know, that kind of thing. It's just because I'm a dick, but...
I think as a party game sort of thing, that would be pretty cool, but I think it'd have limited appeal compared to the full immersion of wearing a VR headset. I think AR can't really go as far as AR can.
But VR isn't full immersion.
Well, VR is full immersion by its definition.
It's not.
It's not.
The only immersion it's given you is visual.
It's more immersive than AR.
It's not sensory, it's not smell.
Yeah, but neither is AR.
I didn't say it was.
Yeah, but I'm saying, VR is more immersive than AR, though. You can't deny that.
It depends.
Depends on what?
It completely depends on the application that you're applying to it. If the immersion that you want is to be able to generate a 3D model in front of you in your actual room, then AR is better.
But what if the immersion is to fly on a magic carpet over an endless landscape? Then you can't
That's why I said
AR.
It depends on the application.
It does.
But it's not just straight away VR is better than AR because it's.
I didn't say it was better, I just said it was more immersive. It can be more immersive.
Can be more immersive depending on the application.
I think AR and VR are both going to be interesting concepts to explore as people who enjoy technical, you know, new technical things that come out. What's the word for that?
And when you're wearing your HoloLens, Steve, I'm going to smack you over the face with my...
I'll be able to see you walk into him with your VR headset accident.
You won't be able to know I'm there.
Yeah, it would cause a massive injury from accidental collision.
I think every single one of us who were... I don't know if you did it to me, but I'm sure you did. When the person had the headset on, we were all doing that to the face, probably.
Yeah. I got Willie out.
Good. Right, moving on. Next. So I think that's enough of worlds that we would like to be in. or something. That was our list for this week. On to the news. Let's get the Witcher stuff out the way first, hey? Because why not? You know, we haven't talked about it for at least 10 minutes. And
there's loads of it as well.
Yeah, there is a lot of it because it's all I want to talk about. All I want to play. I want to play it now. Can we finish early? Right. A new patch came out this week for The Witcher, which I've already talked about, the Bullvine Defense Force Initiative, which, brilliant name, not just a brilliant name, brilliant idea. I also introduced a few things like, I don't seem to have noticed this too much because I think I've looted every container in the entire island anyway, but if you loot a container that's got a candle on top of it, the candle doesn't flicker on and off anymore.
Yeah, but it actually means that you can't light certain candles anymore.
If you ignite them.
Well, if you ignite them, but if you try and light them manually, I was down in a cave and I was trying to light this candle.
Oh, no, that's a bug. That does actually happen. You have to get into the right position sometimes with some candles. It's really weird. Even some big, pyre areas. Yeah, it's ridiculous. Yeah. There's a fair few bugs in the game, don't get me wrong. It's not perfect. It's an open world game at the end of the day. And like I said, I can pick holes in it all day, but it's better than anything ever. one thing that's it's really cool about CD Projekt Red, another thing rather, is that they're supporting the community quite well, and they're releasing 16 major, fairly major kind of free DLC releases. Anything from, you know, new armor, new Gwent cards, all kinds of little things like that, on top of new quests, new things to do. Now, they're also releasing paid content, paid DLC content, which I don't know how much it's going to cost yet, but you can get a season pass if you wanted to, which is going to be substantial. And I trust that it's going to be substantial as well with the way that they do things, because they're giving... Sorry?
I was going to say, Steve, for The Witcher 1 and 2, was there any decent DLC?
Witcher 1, I don't think there was any DLC. The Witcher 2, I think they had two.
Is it good?
I think the first one opened up a complete other island.
That's what the main DLC for Witcher 3 is going to do, the one coming out next year. There's a whole new area.
That's good.
30 hours of gameplay, apparently.
Awesome. That's good DLC.
That'll be an underestimate as well, I imagine, especially in an RPG sense. So I've spent, must be on 50-odd hours now, and I still haven't seen everything in Vizma and Novigrad yet. I'm trying. And they keep opening bloody new quests, even in Skellige, when I'm running around on Skellige. Oh, can you go back to Novigrad and do this for me? Fuck off! Just fucking spend 50 hours running around there! I'm going to, but fuck off! anyway, they're bringing out a new patch as well. And this is going to include a new pig quest, which is a city or an island or a village full of pigs. And it's some crazy... It sounds a bit daft,
like
you know.
Like a cursed island or something.
Yeah, maybe more.
Just what I've always wanted.
There's a world I'd like to live in.
Sounds like some Studio Ghibli.
They're also releasing an entire new Gwent deck as well.
Yay.
This is all free.
I just want to be able to buy some Gwent cards in real life.
We need to push for it, don't we?
They should make it into a real life game that we can go around to each other's houses and play Gwent against each other. I'd be so into that.
I'm pretty sure they will do this. I'm almost certain that they will do this. Someone on Reddit has already done it. Made their own.
Was Gwent in Witcher 2?
No.
Because I thought
it was a different game.
Wasn't there a card game in 1?
There's like a game in each one of them, but they've all been different.
Gwent is brilliant though. It's something really, and I'd love to be able to play against somebody who wasn't AI. You know, I'd love to be able to play against someone who's not predictable. Because even though some of the AI is really difficult, I'm starting to get used to it now, and I'm starting to be like, right, I know what they're going to do. I know that they're gonna, you know, and sometimes I've got a feeling that there's some hacking going on, because sometimes they just conveniently have just the right cards for the deck that I've drawn as well, you know.
In the first one it was Dice Poker. I think that was in the second one as well,
right?
The second one.
I heard that mentioned in 3 actually, the Dice Poker.
We're expecting 16 new DLC releases. I don't know what they are. I haven't looked at them in any detail. I don't know if they've announced them all yet. But I just think it's really cool they're doing this.
The first 4, is it, are already out?
Are they? Oh, actually, you know what? Yeah. I've actually subscribed to the free DLC program, and last night I downloaded them all, so probably merchants and whatever are selling new gear. And
there's the missing minor quest.
Right, I haven't got that yet.
The Tamrian armor set, the Beeden hairstyle set, and an alternative look for Yennefer.
All right,
alternative look? Is this one of the alternative looks that are on Nexus, which include deletion of certain items of clothing?
You can get that anyway, I think.
I know they've done one for Ciri, haven't they?
I've just saved in a bathhouse and everybody's naked. Everybody, including Geralt. It's ridiculous.
There's one thing that's missing from this, which I quite enjoyed about the first game, which was every time you slept with someone, you got a romance card, which is basically just a card of that female.
Oh, I remember that, actually, from the first.
Is that Geralt's notch in a bedpost? Thing? He's got a bedpost with him. He just
You know what? I've declined it every time this time round. I have. I've said
yourself for Yennefer.
I said no. Yeah, I am. I've said no to Kira. I've said no to because Yennefer was in the first scene, and I don't really know what the relationship is between them. Really, I get the impression that they've been together on and off for a bit.
If you read the books, they've basically had this on-off relationship for a ridiculous amount of time.
And she is super hot as well.
Well, they talk about
also the very mysterious.
Yeah,
they talk about the sorceresses. They say that they manage to keep themselves looking young, but they live a long time. But the same is true of witches. Witches age very slowly. Like Geralt's supposed to be about 100 years old, isn't he?
Yeah. Did you say at the start that he's over 100?
Yeah.
The other guy. Vesemir is way older than that, isn't he?
Yeah.
Vesemir's started to look old though now, hasn't he?
There's a couple of. I don't know whether there'll be spoilers. I don't know whether they're going to mention it in this game. They haven't mentioned it in the previous games. But basically, like sorceresses, they can't have children. The same as witches can't have children.
Right.
So the main kind of thing that Yennefer's been looking for all this time is a way for her to reverse that.
All right.
Okay.
That's one of the things she's looking for anyway.
Interesting.
Yeah, she's a bit obsessed with like breaking into places and doing things that she shouldn't be doing and kind of tagging Geralt on along with it. It's a bit weird.
And see, do you think Yennefer's hotter than Ciri? Because when you see the adult version of Ciri, she's quite hot.
I'm not going to have this conversation. I just happened to point out that she was a good-looking sprite, a 3D model rather. You know what? That's one of the things in this game as well. There are very few main female characters, and I'm talking about side quest main female characters that aren't good-looking as well. I think that's probably a bad thing though in general. I mean, there's like the crones, for example. I don't know if you've met the crones yet, anybody, but they are hideous. Absolutely hideous, but
monstrous.
Apart from that, I haven't seen everybody else is gorgeous in it.
Isn't that upholding the standard fantasy trope though of all females in fantasy either being witches or beautiful women
models?
The thing is though, with the majority of the female side characters being sorceresses or somehow inferred in magic, again reading the books, that's actually something that they do to themselves.
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
so
no.
They artificially make themselves really attractive.
There's a few of them, but there's also things like there's Jarl's daughters, and there's one girl I've just run into. I'm not going to mention names or anything. There's one girl I've run into on Skellige, who is pretty beaten up, but she's still a good-looking girl. She's just got a lot of scars and that kind of thing. So there's a variation, but there's a hell of a lot of good-looking women in that game. You know, as far as
I understand what Chris is saying, because I think when you look at the male characters, there's a lot more variation in terms of not all the male characters are good looking. There's a bit more realism there, whereas most of the female ones are either old or young and quite pretty. There's not much variation there.
Geralt, he's the only one. I mean, I'm not sure if Dandelion's a good looking guy because I haven't met him yet, but I assume he is.
In the books, Dandelion sleeps with quite a lot of women.
He's a whore in this so far. Yeah. I haven't met him, but I've just done a whole quest line with him. I'm trying to find him or some. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but I said there's just the constant reminders that he's whoring himself out to everybody and
just
everything.
I've just remembered something as well. Did anyone else hear Charles Dance? Anyone notice it was Charles Dance, the Emperor guy you talked to?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's Charles Dance.
Tywin
Lannister.
Nilfgaardian Emperor.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
I don't know who Charles Dance is, I'm sorry.
Yes, you do. You've
Charles Dance.
Last Action Hero.
Yeah, I just shot someone. I did it on purpose. One of my favourite lines from any film ever.
Oh, him. Right, yes, sorry. His face just popped into my head, yeah. All right, no, I didn't realise that was him.
Alien 3 as well, the Doctor.
Yeah.
He's class Charles Dance. Anyway.
Hang on.
What were you saying?
That he voiced the... So he voiced the Nilfgaardian King who's asked you to find Ciri, that guy.
Yeah. Listen to him again. You'll pick up... He's doing a slight sort of Scandinavian accent, but it's definitely him.
Oh, accents. That's another wonderful thing in that game as well.
Oh, yeah, I like that.
I like the fact that... Well, I'm not sure if I like this or not, but all of the main characters, Yennefer, Ciri... actually, no, I'm not sure about Ciri. I think Ciri's got like an English accent, but Geralt and Yennefer both have American accents, but they're pretty
Yennefer's
much
British.
She's British,
not Yennefer.
Yeah, Yennefer's got Tris. Yennefer sounds Tris. Quite posh.
Tris is American. Anyway,
Tris is American as well.
Okay, right. A lot of the main characters have American accents, but every little village, if you go to a number of different villages around Novigrad and around Vizima. If you go down south, all the villages down south have a similar kind of accent, and it's like sometimes some villages are really strong Geordie, and some of them have got like Darlington accents, and some of them got.
Yeah, I was in a pub and it was like a bar thing and part of the main quest, and this proper big Geordie bloke comes up to me. It's just like weird, the accent in the game.
It's not just that though; it's the way that they've done it in the game. It's really clever that they've done little regions that have, and then Skellige is basically all Irish people.
Irish,
and there's a lot of Scottish people. I think Novigrad is kind of Scottish.
The dwarves are Scottish.
Dwarves are all Scottish.
Yeah. Dwarves have to have a Scottish accent though in everything.
I ran into a Skellige, or whatever you want to call them, in Novigrad, and it's the first time I'd heard a Skellige accent. But they had the attention to detail is wonderful. This is what I'm enjoying.
That moves me on quite nicely to the next bit of news, but the last thing to discuss, vis-a-vis The Witcher, which is the development cost.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, for the amount of detail and the scale of it, the development cost on this thing is ridiculous.
The profit they'll
compared
be making.
Compared to other games.
Well, they've already sold 4 million copies in, 2 weeks, is it? Yeah, two weeks. And
depending on the sources that you read, it's either $15 million or $11 million, or it's all in that ballpark. When you compare
less
that
than $300 million, though, isn't it? That's the point.
A ridiculous amount less.
I guess a lot of that is due to where it was developed, though.
Marco, you know,
like,
as well.
If you think about like Rockstar, for instance, their offices are all in like major cities around the world. They employ people in capital cities, basically, to do the work. Whereas the CD Projekt Red are in Poland, and they just basically get people who are enthusiastic but not commanding massive sums of money.
But they're also still kind of classed as an indie studio, CD Projekt Red. I think they still are classed as... Techland is still an indie studio, apparently. And they've done the two Dead Island games, plus that other zombie game.
Dying Light,
yeah, that everyone's playing.
Given the nature of the industry, though, they don't have to be based in major metropolitan areas.
No, they don't.
I was thinking that as well.
They've chosen to go there. And obviously they've chosen to pass that... to put that cost on the end user, not a direct charge, but by reducing the detail and the amount of work that they're putting into the game.
A lot of it is marketing as well, though, isn't it?
Yeah, GTA and Destiny marketing budgets are bigger than the game budgets.
Well, just goes to show you, though, that it doesn't need that much marketing, because this game, with a tiny budget, has sold 4 million in 2 weeks.
It has been marketed, though.
It has.
I've seen TV adverts for it and stuff. I've seen TV adverts for it.
Nowhere near as much as Grand Theft Auto.
No,
I wonder what their marketing budget is, because it seems to me like this Witcher 3, it seems like it's been made, it's been promoted, and it seems there's been awareness raised about it more than the other two.
I reckon a lot of that is PR, though. I think a lot of the publicity of this game has come because it's a good game.
Yeah, that could be true. I think Dark Souls had that thing where word of mouth was said that it was good, and then it became a big hit rather than... Been a hit out of the park, though. But I suppose there's two sequels that have been widely regarded as being good to give it that good reputation.
Was Witcher 2 a very popular game?
Five million.
It's well reviewed, right? As well.
very well. 5 million, Chris.
It sold 5 million in all, I think, up to now. I mean, they haven't told. I don't think they've released official figures or anything, but that's roughly what it was. I think it's in that article I posted. Yeah, it is a unanimous kind of everybody loves this game. It's 10 out of 10 across the board. Everyone apart from Lou loves this game.
I don't hate the game. I'm just finding it very hard. But I've given it 7.5 hours so far. So it's not like I'm dismissing it.
You can. The thing is, you can get lost in it for hours and not really achieve much. It's that wonderful. I say wonderful. It's. I'd rather play that for 7 hours than play a procedurally generated. I don't know. I don't know what I'd rather play. I just want to play The Witcher now.
Yeah, I don't want to play anything else anymore ever.
Did you take a while to get into it then, Steve? Because I know that you said that you needed to get into this. Have you been playing it from the start, or because?
No. Again, it's been a long time since I played a Witcher game.
Right.
So like coming off the back of playing the likes of Grand Theft Auto, it did take me a little while to get back in again, and I think it was about 4 hours, 5 hours. And then, boom, I was into it. Potions, signs, oils, all going together at once. And you have to kind of get that.
You know what? One thing I wish you could do is bind the potions to keys instead of having to go into the inventory.
You can put them in your pockets, can't you?
Yeah, you put them in your pockets. You can only bind two.
What, really?
Like, I've got...
Sorry. Oils, not potions. Oils. I wish you could bind oils because I'm constantly breaking the kind of feel of the game. What is it called? The flow of the game by going in my inventory and changing my oils over.
I have that too. Where you tell you encounter the appropriate enemy, you're right, I'll put that oil on, then I'll go and kill it.
Because of all the upgrades I've got now as well within my mutagen tree, I have to use oils because even if I didn't want, if I didn't want to kind of expand that area, the way that I've upgraded my character is oils. If I use an oil, I'm going to kill an enemy much, much, much quicker. Not just because there's more damage, because of all the other things that I've got upgraded.
When you're wandering on the wilderness, Lou, pick up every plant you get where you go past.
I have been kind of doing that. I've noticed that the weight limit is actually very lenient.
Like, I've got quite a lot of stuff. And
you can get the saddlebags and stuff as well. Although I have seen mods.
And all that happens is that you can't run anymore. You just got to walk.
But you can still
get on your horse and ride.
Right.
So it's not a massive deal to be overburdened.
No, you don't just like.
Yeah, suddenly start.
Like Morrowind.
Yeah. Actually, even Skyrim, you could walk very, very slowly, couldn't you?
Good, yeah. So, Morrowind and Oblivion, I think, both stopped you over a certain amount. They slow you down and then they just stop you.
And then you just drop a feather or something and then you can just walk full speed.
Yeah, you'd have like a health strength portion which would knock your strength up and you'd be like running out of a dungeon and suddenly you just stop.
The amount of times in those games I'd spend pissed out of my face, staggering back because alcohol gives you an extra 50... strength points, staggering back to my house like that.
So, in summary, would we say that Grand Theft Auto 5 is 23 times better than The Witcher?
Well, objectively, you can't say that it is, surely not. 23 times better.
The single-player game...
Because its budget was 23 times larger.
The single-player game is very good, and you can't deny that. I can't deny that. I thoroughly enjoyed that. However, I'm getting so much more out of The Witcher. So much more. And I think they're going to give us so much more as well.
There's so much more depth to it.
I feel like The Witcher, actually, for the size of world that they've created, there's more engaging reasons for you to go and explore it. Grand Theft Auto is a huge, pretty world with a few hot spots of activity, but most of the places are just... places. They're not, you can't do anything, you can't go into all the houses like you can in The Witcher. I know there's a lot more buildings in Grand Theft Auto, I understand that,
but
there's certain things that Grand Theft Auto did that really confused me. Like, they've got a military base with jets in it that is nothing to do with the main story. Like in San Andreas, which I still think is probably the best one of the series, every single part of that map, the game took you to it and had a mission there and made it relevant. Like, most major areas in that map you had to go pretty much as part of the story, and you had something to do there. You went to the base and you stole the Harrier jet, then you had it. There's nothing like that in Grand Theft Auto 5. That's the sort of stuff that kind of weakens it a little bit, whereas The Witcher feels like every single area of the game has lots of stuff for you to go and do, specifically in every single little nook and cranny of the world.
I'm going to go out on a limb and I'm going to say that I think Rockstar is starting to get a little bit maybe
complacent
and maybe a bit greedy with it. I'm not saying that they're bad at the, what they do, because GTA is still a brilliant game. It's not like I'm offending anybody by saying that and I'm trying to defend myself, but you know what I mean? It's like, I still enjoy playing GTA and I'll still buy GTA 5. They haven't really disappointed me yet. The GTA Online, they could have done it a lot better. They could have implemented the playing with
mates.
They could have
done it better if they didn't do it. They could have done it better if they basically let the community do it, because I think as a saleable product, it is not even close to the quality of the single player game. It's just a sandbox that they tried to tart up.
There is some news about that coming up, where they've released a new patch with, and there's something going on this weekend. But yeah, it feels like it's been tagged on at the end. I don't feel that. I feel like they've planned it, but they've planned it for the long haul. They've planned it to try and keep people playing the game, and that's what I'm talking about with the greediness. The sales models are very much changing these days in general. People want longevity in the game. They want to spend millions on a game, and they want people to pay them back lots more than millions over a longer period. Pay to play, you know, free to play games, these kind of things. And that's kind of what they've done here. Even though you pay £60 up front, you've still got all this DLC coming 2 months down the line. We're going to release a new patch in 3 weeks. Get on this online this weekend because you get a, you know, we've got a special XP deal going on. That happens all across the big games now. Mm. GTA doing it, as I said, this weekend. But we'll get onto that in a minute. Let's talk more about The Witcher.
Yay.
I think the point
that Steve had made before about the budget is still an interesting one. That's sobering thought. The fact that this game, it's fit for an open world game, feels immensely polished, very well put together, cost them £15 million to do it. It's something that other developers should take a look at and say, these are the results that they got out of this budget. If I was a publisher, I'd certainly be thinking, well, why am I spending £300 million on this game getting developed, when these guys made a similar quality experience for £15 million?
It's because they're getting above themselves. They're getting way beyond what, I mean, they're all turning into Hollywood, essentially. That's the problem. And as Steve pointed out, being in Poland, no offence to Poland, but it is a much cheaper country than it is in England or America to live and to work and to hire and, you know, all the other stuff that comes with it. I'm sure they had to pick, most of that will be for the, I imagine, the big voice actors and things like that they've used. Because the voice acting's really good as well, isn't it? I mean, even the bit parts, there's some that are a bit questionable, but not many.
Not really. Generally very good voice acting in the game, yeah.
And the thing that really keeps me going back, on top of everything else, the combat and the magic and everything else, is the fact that I said every single story and every single individual character feels like they have a history, and they feel like they have something about them that makes me want to help them or not help them. I'm actually being a little bit more of a bastard in this game than I am in most RPGs. Usually I'm like angel goody two shoes, but I am being a professional. That was it. That's one of the taglines, isn't it, for this game? It's do you want to be a professional or a saint or something like that? Instead of being a good or bad, you either charge people for everything and make sure you get your money and haggle with people and get, you know, better rates, or you do things for free and let them get away with it.
Well, I've been kind of playing the game following the Witcher code.
Yeah, same. I've been RPGing it. I've been actually role playing.
Have you been making people pay for stuff then?
100% every time. Yeah. And I've even been. There's been occasions where, for example, I've just done a quest where I was sent out on a contract. I negotiated with somebody. When I got to the place that I was doing the contract, I found someone who shouldn't have been there. They were thankful and said, "Oh, I didn't ask your help, but thanks for stumbling on our village. Here, do you want some money?" And I went, "Yep, fucking right, I do." So that's kind of a little bit dubious, but
it's not always charging people, or it's as long as I'm getting something out of it.
Yes. I've had a couple of quests where it's been someone who might have been like dirt poor, and I've haggled with them, and then I've done the quest, and then they've gone all about this, that, and then I've gone, do you know what? On the journey there, I found some good chests and I got paid. Like, keep your money. Or if they've been like, if the person that's been paying me has been like a dickhead, I'd be like, I don't want your dirty money.
So now I've played it quite a lot as well. Quite a lot of the decisions that I've made throughout the game have started to come back and bite me in the arse. Like, I was in an inn and someone jumped up and started saying, like, he was in Vizima the other day and he killed a lot of my mates or whatever, you know, that kind of thing. Whereas that wouldn't have happened if I hadn't made certain decisions earlier in the game, and I don't know what would have happened. I don't know. It still doesn't feel like it affects the world too much, though. unless they've just done it really well. Feels like a lot of the time, I mean, I've tried to make decisions on the spot, like, and I've said something to someone and they've went, well, we're going to do it anyway. You know, it's like, this is the main quest, so we're going to go down this route anyway.
One thing I do like as well is that like sometimes to force you to make a decision in a very short space.
Yeah, that's quite good.
That's good because I sometimes dwell on decisions longer than I should.
You escape it and then go make tea and come back and go.
Yeah, I'll go have a cup of tea and I'll be thinking, well, should I or shouldn't I?
Yeah, that hasn't happened too often though. It's maybe three or four times so far in the entire game. Last bit of Witcher news, which was there is a new patch coming out. No, I spoke about that, didn't I? That was it. We've got no hard level cap on it as well.
Now, this is interesting because the game is not leveled to your character, is it?
Nope.
So, no. Does that mean that at a certain point you're going to be level 500 and everything's going to fall beneath your mighty sword?
Well, if you played it until you're 500, yeah. But I think what will happen is we'll get to a point where we're level 30 or 40 or whatever. We'll have done everything in that game and we'll be happy with it. And we'll be nailing everything. However, just remember that the fights still stay hard. I'm sure when you're level 50 and you've got six wolves running around you, they're not going to do any damage. But, you know, up until... There's still always going to be the level 30 enemies that are going to be crowding around you and beating you up just as much as the level 4s when you're a level 15, you know? I imagine it's still going to be difficult. But they're just going to keep releasing content. And they will keep releasing DLC that's, I think, going to be worthwhile. And as long as it remains worthwhile, I think people are going to keep buying it. Remember as well that Witcher 3 is supposed to be the last of Geralt's story. However, because Witcher 3 has done so well so far, they've already said that they're going to maybe do more Witcher, but not Geralt's story.
Well, I don't know how the story pans out, but there is a young... I mean, I don't know the whole thing about what's going to happen with Ciri at all. No. But Ciri is a young... essentially female Witcher who's really quite powerful, and I don't know her backstory, so they've got a young character there that they could follow it on with.
Backstory, as far as I understand so far, and this isn't spoiling anything, I think this is revealed in 2, you know, so you should already know it, really, is that she is an elder blood.
And I know that bit,
yeah. So she's really powerful. Basically, she moves between worlds, and that's, you know, when you have you played as her yet?
When you do the dodge, you like...
Yeah, I think that must be something to do with moving between worlds. I'm sure Steve knows more about it than I do with him playing the games and reading certain bits. But is there anything he can reveal that's not going to spoil The Witcher 3?
Ciri's not actually mentioned in the books.
No, well, no, you've played 1 and 2, though, haven't you? And I think she's in 2, isn't she?
Yeah, I never completed 2.
Can I just ask then? Are the books set before the games, or is it the same timeline? But
books
different...
are a collection of short stories.
There's a few novels as well, though.
Yeah, but they all... I mean, there's The Last Wish, The Summit Sword. But basically, the timelines aren't very specific in there. You're not sure what's happening when. The only consistent elements are things like Dandelion and Yennefer. And you keep meeting them, and obviously the events that happen kind of make you in your head think, oh, well, that must happen before that, and that must happen before that.
Zoltan Chevy seems to be a... Chevy?
The dwarf.
Dwarf. He seems to be consistent. I met him in the first one when I played it, and he's in this one, so...
Yeah, he's got a few friends that regularly appear. I forget their names now. They're all really bad names. I'm not very good with names.
Fair enough.
Want to do another Witcher, though, they don't have to do it on that timeline. They can do it.
Do any of
that. That's what I'm saying. They could do it whenever. It's that one of those, a bit like an Elder Scrolls thing. They just jump around the timeline and do whatever they want.
They could explore Vesemir's story. They could explore another witch and completely other Witcher. I mean, there's always witches being mentioned.
They could even do it about not a Witcher.
Hasn't even been explored in a great amount of detail. I think Geralt is School of the Griffin, isn't he?
There's a lot of there's a lot of history. So now he's a wolf.
He's a wolf.
There's a lot of history surrounding witches and dragons. Like, under no circumstances is a witcher allowed to kill a dragon.
Oh, really?
Really?
Not at all. It's completely forbidden for them.
Do we know why?
No.
Or you don't, at least. Anyway, it's probably revealed.
I don't, at least. Anyway, someone else might.
That's interesting.
Well, you can kill wyverns and.
They're not dragons.
Other flying beasts of sort. Griffins and...
Not dragons.
Okay.
Yeah, wyverns are not dragons. There's a... Isn't a dragon has am I right thinking the dragon has wings and independent front limbs, whereas a wyvern has its wings attached to, is that the other way around?
The dragon's got rear legs and integral arms and wings at the
and
front.
Can talk, to get,
that's
usually
a dragon.
As well.
Right, okay.
Well, yeah, the dragons can dragons yeah, dragons usually talk in this kind of fantasy lore.
Okay.
Oh, right. That's, anything else for The Witcher? Quiet. It's because he's bored of us talking about The Witcher, I think.
Salisbury.
I'm proper geeking out on it, though. I might even get the books and read them. I'm really, really enjoying everything about it. And I want Gwent. Bring Gwent out immediately.
I posted a link a little earlier into the chat of the cards that someone's printed out, so...
Printing out? I'm not printing.
Shut that
into
Skype as well, though. I'm not in the chat.
I can't at the moment, so I'll send it later.
You could always Google it later, I think. Anyways... Yeah.
It's not particularly difficult to play either. I mean, I imagine it'd be fairly quick to play it, even though it adds everything up for you and does all of the calculations. But once you figure out the rules and what all the special cards do, I imagine it wouldn't be too difficult to go. Because I'm at a point now where I'm like, I'm playing a card without reading it, so I know exactly what every card's going to do to the board at any time. And I make the odd occasional mistake, but I'm getting awesome at it.
Oh, I found them, Luke.
Cool.
Right, any more Witcher stuff, or is that done with
no,
The Witcher?
Let's move on to boring games. So, Don't Starve Together. Sorry to the Don't Starve Together devs. Every other game is boring, not just yours. Don't Starve Together has now released the Don't Starve... Oh, hang on, no. Don't Starve has now released the Don't Starve Together content for Don't Starve owners for free.
That's cool, because I own that game.
So do I, and I've been waiting for it to come out, because I could have got the pre-release DLC thing. So we can have a game of that together at some point when we finish playing The Witcher.
When you've finished playing The Witcher, which is also when the universe dies of heat death.
Are you not playing it anymore, then?
Playing what, Witcher?
Yeah, you just said when I finished playing it.
Yeah, when you finish playing it, we'll be a lot further into the future than when I've finished playing it.
Fair enough, right. It is amazing, that's why I'm playing it. I didn't know. Right, so yeah, I'll pause that in chat.
Like the, remember when you first started playing Final Fantasy VII, and you couldn't really get your head around what was really happening until... things fell into place and you got outside Midgard.
Hmm.
It was just like...
I think it was well before then.
Oh, that was the first time, like, the whole scale of it hit you.
Yeah.
And it's like the possibilities of, like, what could happen.
I think a more pertinent thing from my point of view is when I played Deus Ex the first time, tried to play it twice, uninstalled it because I just couldn't get into the Statue of Liberty, which is the first fucking level. Because I just try and run, up to the front door and blow it up with a rocket launcher and killed by all the robots and
instantly,
stupid men.
No matter
so
what
I,
you did, yeah.
I am playing this game in a really ham-fisted, stupid way. I know I am because I'm getting battered by everything and I always have no health and
I do this much damage.
No, I know. I'm getting to the point. The point is, I recognize that this is a pattern that is repeated before. And that all I've got to do is figure it out. It has to click in my mind, and then I'll enjoy it. Not when I enjoy it, I'll also probably go back to things like Dark Souls and enjoy them, because suddenly I'll be able to play third-person games where you walk off ledges all the time, and I won't walk off the ledge all the time. That's the point I'm making. It will be a key. It'll be kind of a gateway drug to those games for me.
I've got to tell you that if walking off your ledge, you think that's bad in Dark Souls, just by actually fighting the enemies, my God.
Well, yeah.
You're going to rage quit in about 30 seconds.
It's not the same game as Dark Souls. Dark Souls is a very different type of third-person game to this. It's...
Very different kind of combat, but still, I would say they're both very, very punishing. Hmm. And they both games say, no, you learn our mechanics, get good at that. That's the only way you're going to beat it. It's not a case of play the game you want to play it the way you want it. It's like, no, play the game the way we want you to play it.
Yeah.
Play it to our rules, and then you might get good.
And
you have to get good.
Yeah, and it does take me a long time to get into those sort of games. And when I do, I really enjoy them. Like, all of the stealth games, I didn't get into any stealth game until I played Splinter Cell. And then it clicked. Splinter Cell made it click for me. And then I could play all the stealth games. I love stealth games after that. And I think the same thing will be true for The Witcher. It's just, like you say, it's a game which demands of you more attention and to play it the way that it has been designed, rather than just... bool through it like a seasoned gamer.
I think a lot of RPGs tend to sort of do that thing where it's like, oh, you build your class and do it your way, whereas I think this is a more role-playing game in the actual sense of take on the role of Geralt and play as him. Mm. It's that kind of thing. You know, I like that.
So Mythalos just said something in chat which is relevant to what we said earlier. It seems that Geralt doesn't kill dragons because he considers them sentient beings who are more victimized by humans than the perpetrators of violence against humans, according to the official Witcher wiki. Okay. So there you go.
Well, according to the book, it's against the Witcher code to kill dragons.
Well, okay. Maybe it's not just Geralt that feels that way. Maybe he has personal feelings about it as well, yeah. Maybe. Anyway, shall we actually move on from The Witcher? As much as I would like to keep talking about it, it's been an hour and a half now. We do need to talk about some of the other news. So I did just mention Don't Starve Together. So it's, again, I'm not sure how it's going to work. I don't know how the early access went. I haven't seen it being played. Has anybody got any experience of it or at least seen it? Don't Starve Together. So the multiplayer aspect of Don't Starve. Did you play Don't Starve?
I played Don't Starve, yeah.
Right, so I quite enjoyed Don't Starve for about, I don't know, 12 hours, and then after that I was like, I'm not actually getting anywhere with this. It's really difficult.
The multiplayer thing is free. If you've already owned a copy, then you get it free.
Yeah.
That's so, quite good.
It is quite good, but you could have bought the early access for like 12 quid or something if you wanted to before, but I just waited. I'll have a go of it at some point. Simple as that. If anyone in chat has played it, Don't Starve Together, with friends, obviously, not just on your own, then let us know. See what your opinions are. I'm going to have a go at some point, as I said. Oculus Mobile VR Jam 2015 winners.
This is what I was looking at while you guys were talking about Witcher. I've just looked through all the entries. I didn't even know anything about this, and I'm probably going to whack my Oculus on tonight, maybe, or tomorrow, and play through some of these, because some of them look brilliant.
Yeah, they do. I can't remember where I saw the article now. I think maybe it was on Twitter. Someone posted it, but yeah, it looks quite intriguing. Some of the ideas.
Steve, have you looked at this? Are you looking at this page? If you scroll down to the game Drift, it's the orange screenshot, the third game down.
Yeah,
that's a lot like a concept that we came up with a couple of years back, a first-person bullet simulator.
Or you play.
Well,
you've got to
guide the bullet rounds. Yeah, we actually came up with a concept that we prototyped in Unity a few years back, and someone's done it, but they've done it in VR, which is interesting.
Do you do it for copyright?
No, probably not.
Did you copyright
release it?
No, we didn't release it. We had a playable prototype, but we didn't take it much further than that.
Well, this is your own fault. You should always release things and get them out.
We had grand designs for it though. We went a lot further than that game did. But
ours would have been better than this.
Yeah.
Of course.
Okay, cool. So anyway, I just thought that was a nice little list for people to have a look at in dinner time or whatever.
Some of those look very, very pretty indeed.
Powi-Fi. You heard about this?
No.
They're not going to call it Powi-Fi. That just sounds gay.
Power over Wi-Fi, that's what it is. So now, essentially, some I can't even remember where it is exactly. I haven't read the article recently, but someplace somewhere has invented this. Well, not invented it. Wi-Fi apparently has power available, so we could actually charge our mobile phones and handheld devices and things like that.
That's because it's electromagnetic radiation.
Of course, it everything does. Everything will.
Well, any electromagnetic wave will induce some current in things. It won't be much.
Well, right. I don't care if that's obvious or not. It wasn't obvious to me as a standard consumer.
Have you heard of a crystal radio, Chris?
No.
It's a radio that's powered by the radio waves rather than the battery. It's been around since the 50s, I think.
The most self-powered thing I've seen is wind-up radios.
Right.
Kinetic power.
Before that, there used to be crystal radios where you'd have a really long antenna and the radio waves themselves would power the radio.
Cool.
That worked on the same principle.
But I mean, this is promising to me personally. I'd quite like to get rid of cables, and the more cables we can get rid of, the better. As long as they all don't, you know, all the signals don't conflict with each other. But charging your phone while you're at your house without having to plug it in—that's pretty cool. They've got a new wireless charging thing coming out with the Galaxy S6, where it's not necessarily wireless, but you basically put it on a charger.
A charge pad?
Yeah, they've been doing that for ages.
It's a circular pad thing, and you just plonk it on top of it.
Well, it's a copper coil that uses induction.
Yeah,
it's
so
a thing.
My phone does it.
All Windows phones do it, though. All the new Nokias do it.
I don't follow gadgets. I follow computer games. So, anyway, it's just saying.
It's
I'm actually getting an S6.
Have you heard about this new invention, guys? It's called the wheel.
Yeah! Yesterday, we used fire to cook meat. And it was fucking fantastic. I feel great.
The Xbox One has a new release coming out with a 1 terabyte hard drive and a new controller.
This is interesting, actually, because the Xbox controller, I would say, is pretty close to perfect.
It
I have played on an Xbox One.
Do you know what the difference is for the new controller?
Go on.
It's got a 3.5mm audio jack in it.
Awesome.
Oh. You can plug your headphones into your controller.
All right. Basically. Didn't the old one have that?
No, that adds a headset one.
All right.
But you couldn't actually listen to the game through it. You could only broadcast your voice and hear your voice.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, so 1 terabyte storage, though, it's pretty good. Can't complain about that for a console. I mean, it should probably be more than that these days, but, you know, we are where we are.
Considering all games are download only, pretty much, or getting that way, then the 1 terabyte will quickly be consumed by 60 gig installs of games.
Yeah, it's install... No, you know what, it won't, because I've got a 2 terabyte hard drive on my computer, and I'm not even hitting 700 gig yet, and I've got every game under the sun installed. I've got a lot of games installed.
I haven't bought a hard drive
in
a long time.
I've also got a lot of big databases on that hard drive. So screw
off. Yeah, I've got 700 gigs free still, so I'm doing well.
1.55 gig of 3 terabytes, so about half of it I'm taking up.
I've got out of a 2 terabyte drive, I've got 470 gig left.
Right, is that just a game drive? Games?
Pretty much.
I've got
2 gig sort of storage drive. Anyway.
Yes. 2 gig. That's a fair amount. So that's coming out on the 16th of June in the USA at $399. Again, I don't know if that's good or not. I've lost interest in how much consoles cost. I don't think I'm ever going to buy a console again, actually. I think I've had enough of them.
Because the exclusive content's still quite tempting when they do release decent exclusive content.
What, though? What is exclusive at the moment that I can't get on PC?
No, nothing at the moment, which is why I haven't bought an Xbox One or a PS4.
I think that's a really bad reason to have to buy a console, is because they will not allow you to play it on other machines. I think that's a really dodgy move by the games industry.
But it's always been that way.
Doing it for a long time, though, haven't
they? They have been doing it for a long time, but there was reason to do it before, when it took actual effort to port it to different machines. Now they develop on PCs anyway, and basically the game can be on any machine, but they choose not to. Hmm. I think that's really dodgy.
I'm with you there, and it is annoying that that's the case, but it is will always be the case. It's all to it all depends on licenses, you know, what they've agreed with publishers and various platforms and all that bollocks, isn't it? I've got a PS4, but even though the PS4 is going to get Phantom Pain before the PC, I think it's supposed to be beforehand. I'm going to wait 2 weeks, I think, and get it on PC, because it's so much better. I'm sorry, console gamers, but...
On a slight tangent here, but you mentioned Phantom Pain. Have you seen that there's a 20-minute gameplay video that's come out, I think it was today?
It's a preview, I've not watched it yet. I know that they've been letting game reviewers do previews of the game, haven't they, as a promotional thing, so they get to play it for...
I know you've been I know, Chris, you've been avoiding the publicity for it, but yeah, there's 20 minutes of gameplay in this new preview.
I won't be watching it.
I'll be looking at it.
It's one of those things that I know that I want to play that game. I don't want to spoil a single second of it. Bugs and all, you know. I don't want to spoil anything. I don't care that Kojima's not involved anymore either. I just want to play the goddamn thing.
It'll be all but finished now anyway, won't it? The game, the development of the game is probably all but done.
They'll be fixing little bugs and...
Yeah.
Making sure his leg doesn't raise 2 millimeters too high off the ground and stuff like that. If they can be asked, actually.
Adding more detail to his ass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Someone actually asked in chat, I think it was Jedi in chat, asked if we were going to talk about Fallout 4. But we talked about Fallout 4 last week, thinking about it. We haven't got any news about it this week, so...
Well,
I don't
yeah.
think Steve was on last week to give his thoughts on it, though. If you've seen the trailer, Steve, and what you thought about
it. I was
going to
put the link in the chat thing, but I just couldn't attend the show.
Oh, well, there you go. I would say one thing. At least it's in-game engine trailer. It's not a lie. Like, there's a lot of trailers where they go, oh, is it a new Assassin's Creed trailer? You're like, no, there's a new Assassin's Creed CGI movie. Like, it's not the game. So I would say, give him credit that at least, even if you might say the graphics aren't great, at least Bethesda said, well, this is what the game world actually, like,
that's
this
true.
Is what the game engine actually looks like.
That is laudable, yeah.
As I said this last week, I don't have a problem with how his ass looks or how shit the dog is, really. I mean, it is shit, the dog looks shit, but it's still going to be a Fallout game, and I'm still probably going to really enjoy it.
I've always been more of a fan of The Elder Scrolls as opposed to Fallout.
I really enjoyed 3. I haven't played 1 and 2, although I have got them.
I thought 3 was a fantastic game. I thought Fallout 3 was better than Oblivion. And Fallout 3 was what Oblivion should have been.
I found some of the... I think the level cap in Fallout 3 really pissed me off. Because I'd reached... I think, was it 30? Is the level cap?
Yeah, it is.
I'd done that before it even barely touched the main quest. So I was like, oh, come on.
That rings bells,
actually. That annoyed the hell out of me. I don't know why they did that. That was because they... That was one of the things where Bethesda was trying to make that game appeal more to the mass public. They marketed that game as a shooter when they should have made it as an RPG. And I think it was a good RPG, but they pushed in a lot of mainstream shooter stuff into it. That
see, I
the level cap that annoyed the shit out of me.
I didn't play Fallout 3 like a shooter. I used the VAT system the whole way through, which is unusual for me because I should technically play that game like a stealth shooter, like everything else that I try and play.
I used a combination, really. I mean, sometimes if I was fighting super mutants, for example, I'd be like, I want to get a headshot on them bastards, so I'd VATS it. But I always would, I'd only ever use VATS if I kind of, I'd weave like hell, get really, really close to the enemy, you turn VATS on and then headshot them so that they were dead. But if I was miles away, I'd be sniping them manually, you know, or something like that.
Steve, what was your... I remember every time I hear the word, the phrase super mutants, I just remember you ranting about super mutants. He gets sick of killing them. What was that?
No, it was like, you know, you go through the story and, you know, you do this, you have your birthday, your dad disappears, blah, blah, blah. You climb up the vault and I just got attacked. I just got raped by super mutants at every possible point. At this point, I've got like a stick and an empty bottle of the new cola. And like... What do I, you know, so I stopped playing it for about 6 months.
One of the best things, though, is just jamming two weapons together to make one better weapon. Just brilliant, best thing you can ever do.
Two guns just slam together and make one better.
I don't know if we mentioned this last time, but I will say one of the things that I really liked about that trailer was the fact that it looks like the worlds that they built, I don't want to call them levels, but the sections, you know, they show you a bit of the city, they show you a bit of the wasteland, they show you this, that and the other. I like the fact that they look like there's more variety and they look a lot more interesting. I really like that because as much as I love Fallout 3, there was a lot of sort of greyish landscapes with not a lot there and the occasional burnt out car for miles and miles and miles.
That was my main observation when I watched the trailer, was that I liked the look of the world. It's back to what I said earlier about the every location having a different vibe to it. I like that.
I think that looks very promising. So I'm actually quite hyped for it. I mean, I want to play Fallout 4.
I'm not hyped for anything right now. I can't get hyped about anything at all right now because all
it begins with a W and has a 3 at the end of it.
All I want to do is play Warcraft 3. That's right. That is exactly right, Lou.
The Frozen Throne.
The Frozen Throne. No, I am hyped about Fallout 4. I loved 3. I thought it was amazing. I wish I was around, or I wish I was into isometric games when 1 and 2 were out, because I'm sure I would have enjoyed them. They're on my GOG list. You know, I've got them, and I mean to play them at some point, but with all the other games...
I keep meaning to go back and try New Vegas.
Same.
Apparently that's a lot better.
People have said that. I've played a good few hours of that, and I didn't like it as much as Fallout 3.
Nuka-Cola Quantum. One of our new guests, Jelly Donut, has said, by the way, Nuka-Cola Quantum is the best. You know, we had a list the other week
Can you kill super mutants with it?
Probably.
She can kill Super Newton.
What does Nuka Cola Quantum do? What, I forgot that was the rare one, and there was a quest for it. But what does it do? I've forgotten. It was important. It was kind of like a quest to find all the Nuka Cola Quantum bottles for some reason. Does it give you like boost of health when you drink it or something? There's something about that. Mr. Man who put that in the chat, can you remind us what's so good
Jelly
about
Donut,
it?
Jelly Donut, tell us all about Nuka Cola Quantum.
I can't remember what it was for. It was definitely a quest though, yeah.
One thing I remember about Fallout 3 as well is that when I eventually managed to get any distance away from the vault, I stumbled across this old kind of city area, and I managed to get a full suit of armour from one of these Steel Brotherhood or whatever it was.
Mm-hmm. But
you couldn't wear it.
No, but it made me overburdened. But I was thinking, well, this is obviously really good. I don't want to get rid of this. I need to put it somewhere. And then I got ripped by a suit of mutants.
Again. Have you
is
actually
that
played
every
that game?
Story
much?
Ends.
That's how every time I play Fallout 3
I was playing
ends.
Gwent one day. And I got ripped by suit of mutants. Right.
Do you know what's weird? When I played Fallout 3, I didn't encounter a super mutant for a long time. Same. When I first saw them, I was like, whoa, are these guys?
There's one time where you come out of a subway and you go kind of around, and you're doing one of the main story missions. That's where the super mutants appear. I don't know how you found one so early on.
Like a farm thing. It was like an abandoned building on a hill, and there was a lot of them running around there, but I didn't find them that hard. I was using vats all the time and just blowing their heads off.
I was using vats, but I could only get, like, obviously with a really poor level, I could only get about a 12% chance of a headshot. Mm. Even if I did hit him, it just went ping.
And then you're ripped by super mutants.
And Dogmeat just stood there watching, doing nothing.
No, running towards him, going.
Dead. Dogmeat has died. No shit.
Let me lick your mutant skin. Die. Stamp.
Yeah. Don't rip by super mutants.
So how much did you play of Fallout 3, Steve?
Let me tell you.
12 minutes.
I've completed that game twice, like from beginning to end.
I got it on PS3 first. No, Xbox 360, sorry, and I completed it on that. And then I got it on PC and completed it on this.
About 11 hours.
Oh, so not too
bad.
That's
quite a lot then.
It's a lot of riffage.
Yeah. It is, yeah.
I seem to remember getting to a big rusty oil tanker.
Yeah, that's part of the main quest. It's like a city, isn't it?
Yeah. I like that. That's cool.
You know what?
That's
I got
the
all the
city centre.
I did the same with Oblivion. I played Oblivion to death on PC, and then I got it on 360, so I did it the other way around with Oblivion. I got it as part of someone sold me like 30 games for 30 quid, and Oblivion was on there, and I thought, oh, I'll have a go at this, because I was really into consoles then. And I did the same that way around, and forgot what I was going to talk about.
Nuka Cola Quantum gives you 20 action points for 4 minutes, 20 extra action points.
There you go. So it was very useful. The action
very
points.
Useful, yeah.
No, that's how you power your vats, so the action points are really useful.
Mm. I didn't ever use them. Not really.
Sorry, game advertised on Steam called Sperm Nation. And it looks like you're a sperm and you get to create the most hideous babies in the world.
Hey.
Proper deformed.
Okay.
It's got very positive reviews.
Good times.
It's anything that does that, though, it's got to have good positive reviews, isn't it? Right, so moving on. GTA 5 Online has an ill-gotten gains update that's just come out today. Oh, God, I've turned into the 1980s. I've gone all funny. My cameras went all funny. Ill-gotten gains updates coming out today, as I said, and this includes new game modes, new free roam activities, new daily objectives and rewards. These are all kind of things that are already in the game. And then there's a friend manager, so you can actually do all the friend management stuff that we couldn't do when we were playing it in the game instead of having to go onto the website. Amazing! It's only taken up a year or longer. And there's some kind of photo contest as well. Plus, there's this weekend they've got like extra XP and free online T-shirts. It's all nonsense. I have to.
They only do that to get. They'd only be doing that if they were trying to get people to play it desperately.
Well, yeah.
And they'd only be trying to get people to play it desperately if they were trying to put some kind of freemium content in there.
I know, and I it's not that I've given up with it. I just haven't played it for weeks now. Anyway, but I'm...
It's the same thing, Steve, Chris, technically.
Well, no, okay. It's not that I consciously went, I've had enough of this. That's what I think my point is. It's that...
Something better came along.
That and...
Yennefer's ass appeared on your screen and you were hooked forever.
That, yeah. And, sorry, I want to reset my camera because I look really skewed. No, still doing it. Anyway, I don't like the fact that you can't play with your friends very well. You know, you can't actually play with mates easily in that game. And that's
I think that's always going to be a situation with a 40 square mile map.
No,
I don't know if there's any way around that.
There's obviously a way for you to be able to spawn in your friend's car or spawn with your friends or with your crew. That kind of stuff would help it immensely. You wouldn't have to spend an hour trying to find each other on the map every time.
Didn't World of Warcraft have a pretty big map and people seemed to do all right on that, didn't they?
Yeah,
but you go into parties and you don't move very fast, whereas in Grand Theft Auto you can move very fast and quickly get away from your friends.
There are lots of things that they could have done to improve that, they could do to improve that, but they just, I don't know. The thing is, if you think about how people play games these days, online games, and massively multiplayer online games specifically, is that they play them with randomers generally. They don't just go, if you want to play with your mates, you play a clan match, you play a quick match of Call of Duty or you know, some kind of arena-based thing, don't you?
It's balanced. It's balanced and it's contained, and I think those are the two problems that Grand Theft Auto Online has. It's not balanced. You'll spawn and someone will be flying around in a massive flying tank shooting rockets at you.
It's balanced enough, I think. I think you just didn't give it enough chance. I spent maybe a couple of hours and I got enough money to get a decent set of guns and I could kill anybody. But you're just rubbish at games, so that's probably why. That's probably why, Lou.
From what I remember, aren't the better guns locked off to you when you're at a certain level? You go into ammunition, you can't buy the good weapons.
But they make very little difference. In my experience, once you've got an automatic machine gun of some sort, you're good enough to go. You don't need the top level ones. You just need those because you've got variation then. I stuck with the bullpup for the entire time, and you get that at the beginning.
The thing is, if someone is hiding on a rooftop a million miles away and they shoot you and you die, then you've got to respawn and...
So you turn on that immunity mode.
Passive.
Yeah, but then you're not participating in the game anymore.
Until
you're basically playing single player with other people around.
To an extent, you can then go in lobbies and arenas and have more controlled matches.
Or you can watch the loading screen for 30 minutes, which is more likely.
There is that. I'm not trying to defend it because it is badly implemented and the loading screens are ridiculous. But, you know, still, it's...
We've done Grand Theft Auto.
Hey. We have. Let's not repeat ourselves too much. Latest Humble Bundle has loads of indie classics. So in here we're talking about... this came out yesterday, I think. In here we're talking about Antichamber. The other
Braid.
One. Hey?
Suit of Meat Boy.
Yeah, Suit of Meat Boy. That was the one that was in my head. Couldn't remember. There's a few of them anyway. There's a few Risk of Rain, that kind of thing.
Limbo. Again.
Yeah, Limbo. If you haven't...
Like anyone...
Yeah, anyone doesn't own Limbo by now. If you don't own any of those games, especially Antichamber, get on it.
Unless you're left-handed, in which case...
If you are left-handed, learn to be right-handed and play Antichamber.
Yeah.
I'll just swap my prefrontal cortex around.
Yes, and you should. There is something about Ratchet and Clank in the document.
I think I'm the only person that gives a shit about this, but... I think it's quite interesting that because they're releasing a movie, they're actually rebooting the franchise with a remake of the first game, but they're remaking it and tying it into the film's narrative. So it might be a companion that goes along with the movie, but it's an interesting movie just that I've not seen it done before, where they're not making a tie-in, like, you know, they make a Spider-Man movie and they make a tie-in game for it. This is a gaming franchise that's becoming a movie, and they're then rebooting it and redoing the first thing all over again. But doing a new story, so it's going to be not just a remake, but it's going to be a new story that they're tying in to the film that they're releasing to the general public as well. And I just thought it was quite interesting, and also the gameplay looks pretty cool. I've always loved the ridiculous gadgets and guns you get in Ratchet and Clank.
Do you think that this move will break it out of the kind of niche sort of cult market that it is? Because it is a very much a cult game, isn't it?
It depends how they market it. I think the aesthetic style that the characters have got it lends itself well to the kind of family market that would go and watch a DreamWorks or Pixar animated movie in the first place. So if they market it that way and go, oh, isn't this a fun, like, adventure with a talking cat thing and a robot who jump around and blows stuff up with big crazy guns, then yeah, it could well reach a whole different audience that would never have even known about it beforehand, who then might find out there's a game and then get the game afterwards, possibly. I don't know.
I've never even seen those games being played. I don't even know how they work. I don't know what they are, really. I'm sure they're brilliant.
They're ostensibly, you put them under the platformer thing, but they're not. There's platforming sections in them, but they're more an action-adventure game with a lot of platforming in them that are quite a lot of big, ridiculous weapons that are really good fun, very silly weapons, and just a lot of, and quite a lot of outer space. You go to different planets and do different missions on the planets and do different side quests and stuff like that. So there's quite a lot of kind of RPG stuff in them as well. So it's a good series, man. As I've always said, it's a good series. And I'm looking forward to there being a new one and a film as well. I think I might be the only person in the theatre watching the film, unless it's really well advertised and it catches on. I'm interested. It could be, I hope it's a good movie, because I want like a really good video game movie to exist for one game at some point in my life. It would be really nice.
There's nothing wrong with Mortal Kombat, Sam. Shut up.
I really like the first Mortal Kombat.
I really like the soundtrack to the first one.
Calling it a good movie and an enjoyable movie is a distinction. It's the sort of thing where I say Commando is a fucking really enjoyable movie. Is it good?
Oh, slightly off subject, but speaking of Arnie films, I recently watched Maggie, his latest entry into the zeitgeist, and it's really good.
Oh, is that the one where it's... Go on.
It's a zombie film, but it's a zombie film with a difference slightly. It's more focused on the humanity side of things rather than the zombies attacking and destroying and killing everybody. And he's actually acting in it, you know? And he's,
I've heard it's supposed to be pretty good, isn't it?
It is really
good. In the
third
act, does he scream, "Get to the chopper!"
No, but I was screaming that all the way through myself. No, there's absolutely no, there's not a single Arnie line in it. It's not an Arnie film. It's not an action film or anything like that. It's a really well shot and really well directed and really decent story, interesting zombie film. But I think it's well watched.
Is it out at the cinema? Because it's kind of, that must have flown under the radar.
It's not out in the UK.
Okay, fair enough. Say no more.
I went to America to watch it.
Speaking of movies, did you see that thing about Uwe Boll?
Yeah, he's late.
Who's he fighting now?
Well, his latest project fell through, didn't he?
Yeah. After three unsuccessful crowdsourcing campaigns, he's basically just turned around and said, "Fuck yous all."
I'll fight the lot of you. Good, go away, Yui. We don't like you.
Stop making terrible fucking films about games, you bellend.
Right, I wish not to turn this into a movie podcast, because it is a game podcast. But yeah, I just wanted to say that about Arnie. Right, okay. Next game thing, World Video Game Hall of Fame inducts Pong, Pac-Man, Super Mario Bros. Pac-Man. Super Mario Bros. Tetris, Doom, and WoW, World of Warcraft, I assume. That's quite a lot of Nintendo games as well. Or Nintendo published games, at least.
Yeah, I think it's probably because this will be a very America centric Hall of Fame.
Oh, not World, though, obviously. Like the World Series.
They are, yeah, but yeah, exactly. But yeah, exactly, yeah.
I love how they call it the World Series, but it's only played in one country.
They are interesting. I actually had a think about this, and I can't think of many games that I would supplant these choices with. I think they're very good choices. They all are very culturally significant, which is a bit different from being great games. They are just very games that were big at the time.
I can imagine, yeah, there's the games that are sort of landmarks. Whether they're great or not is not really the point. It's more about whether they captured the gaming cultural zeitgeist, you know.
Mm.
So therefore, your games like Halo are going to be in there. That kind of stuff, they had an impact. They were big.
I think World of Warcraft is probably the most controversial of the entries there.
How could that be controversial? That game was hugely impactful game onto the gaming world. How could it not be in there? I've never even played it, and I'd say it's got to be in there. Surely.
Yeah,
It's like a drug.
I can't think of another game that, again, like I said, I can't think of any games that supplant these. But it's like, I guess because it's the most modern game there, it feels like the weakest because it doesn't have the heritage, even though it does have a lot of heritage, and it came out in 2005.
I've not seen the list, because when I tried to look at it, I ran into a bit of trouble with the old internet again. Having Skype running and opening that window was making all your voices go horrible, so I just closed the window.
No, we were just putting voices on.
It's up against Tetris and Pac-Man and Pong, which somehow sound like they got more gravitas to them.
Well, what else is in the Hall of Fame? Because these are six those new are inductees.
Those are the first inductees into the Hall of Fame.
I see. They're going to jump in with these six, and these. You'll probably say, "Well, now why didn't they put in Space Invaders or something instead?" I can kind of see that argument.
Yeah, I mean, Mythamol in the chat has just said Minecraft should be there. In terms of cultural impact, yes, it probably should be. Although I don't think it should be in there for a while. Because again, it feels too new. But it's certainly, I think Minecraft probably resurrected the whole indie gaming scene single-handedly.
The thing about a Hall of Fame is that traditionally it's something that is like past its use, like a shelf life, and then it's kind of retrospectively put in. Like when their music artists are put into the Music Hall of Fame, it's normally after they've had their big like hurrah, then they start the tail off.
Yeah, they've had essentially their career is already kind of done.
Yeah.
Not done, but they've already had their big career.
Yeah.
Now they're being inducted into the Hall of Fame. Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure that World of Warcraft, it's still popular, but it's not in its heyday anymore.
Oh yeah, it's on its dying. It's starting to recede definitely.
But I mean, all the others, I'm pretty.
Well, the next newest game there is Doom, and that's over 20 years old now. That's just 93 that came out.
I imagine
so. There's a big jump.
Imagine Super Mario Brothers is the original that they're referring to as well.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, the NES version.
Yeah. Huh. Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Cool. Nice. Is that being
worth watching?
So is that being National Museum of Play? So is this like a what do you call it? Adjudicated kind of.
It's to all intents and purposes an official Hall of Fame. It's not just something someone's made up. Well, it is something someone's made up, but it's recognised.
Yeah, okay, that's what I meant, is it recognising. Biggest collection of playable games in the world at Newcastle. What does that even mean? What?
In the Life Centre in Newcastle at the minute, well, from basically the end of May up until the beginning of November, they have got the largest collection of playable games in one place.
Oh, Game On. Oh, I've heard of Game On before. They move around, I think.
This is Game On 2, though.
I'm going there.
When?
I don't know, but Helen wants to take me there. So.
Because I'm going as well.
I was
going
to say, I'd like to go.
Why don't we all meet up there?
We should go. Sam?
Sam, do you reckon you could make it to Newcastle?
When's this, sorry?
Any time up till November.
Yeah, I dare say that I could at some point, yeah.
We should arrange it then.
For a Thursday, because on a Thursday it's open from 10 till 8 in the evening.
We'll see if Alex wants to go as well. He lives in Newcastle.
Yeah, there's no chance of me coming over on a Thursday, mate. It's going to have to be a Friday or a Saturday.
Why?
Because it's the middle of the week and I work.
We all work.
So I work. But you work for yourself.
Yeah.
So arguably, it's easier for you to get the day off.
You're just going
to
sweet talk your boss.
Arguably, it costs me a hell of a lot more to take time off work. That's why I work Monday to Friday.
Yeah,
anyway,
let's
talk about it outside of this this thing. I also have to ask you something else as well, Sam, so remind me after this call, all right? Keep forgetting to ask you something. Right. Okay, cool. Yeah, good. Up for that. What's the next one? Sequel to XCOM.
Yeah, didn't we talk about this last week?
Yeah, who's put this in here?
Me, I wasn't here last week.
All right, okay.
Oh, even watch the show if you're not here.
I was in Latvia.
You haven't been in Latvia since then, though. You could have watched the show, your dinner break or something.
No, but I've been catching up on stuff.
Lazy
and
bastard.
Very hungover.
So what do you think of this then, Steve? And have you recognised the fact that it looks very similar to XCOM Apocalypse?
Yeah. They've done a very good job with Enemy Unknown.
I agree.
More of the same wouldn't necessarily be a bad thing.
Yeah. And I think exploring the apocalypse-style gameplay in its city, and it's more of a... It's almost a mixture of... Do you remember Ghostbusters on the 8-bit? It's kind of like that, isn't it? You send your team out to buildings and stuff. I think that's quite nice. I think that could work really well. I just hope they aren't making the same mistake that they made with Apocalypse, because Apocalypse was a massive flop, because it was too complicated. and it did it strayed too far from the winning formula.
They still need to have that balance of tactics and action. If it's too much action, you're going to lose people. If it's too much tactics, you're going to lose people.
Yeah, and I lost a lot of people with Apocalypse because it had a real-time mode as well. It had turn-based or real-time mode, which was bizarre, playing a squad-based game in real-time.
Yeah. We'll see anyway. There's very little details out for it at the moment.
Yeah, it was just a launch trailer, wasn't it? Anyway, we're coming up to the end of the show because we're dropping frames now, apparently, anyway. Twitch is having issues, or we're having issues on my internet or something. So, unless there is any other business, we shall close.
No? I think that's it, yeah.
So, what you can take from this, everybody, is that you should buy The Witcher 3. It is amazing. And that is all I'm going to be talking about for at least the next 10, 15, 20, maybe the next 52 shows.
Next week, E3. E3 coverage starts on Sunday and runs through till next week, and we'll be right in the middle of it when we broadcast next week, so we should have a lot of...
It's pointless to already release Witcher 3.
Witcher 4, maybe? Witcher 3.5?
I don't care what's coming out at E3.
Geralt gets his end away.
Again. Geralt gets his end away.
In a dragon.
Geralt buries
that's
a dragon.
That's the only way witchers can have children, is to shag a dragon.
Geralt's a dragon fucker.
Because there's only one dragon left in the world, and that dragon's... Yeah, anyway, let's not go into too much sexual
detail. And it's Geralt's mission to seduce it.
Yes.
Submit your fanfictions in the chat below.
Oh, don't. Please don't, for the love of God.
Fucking Greg must be typing away furiously now.
Resonance Arcade / Witcher 3 porn .tumblr.com or something. Don't know why there's a / in the... third level domain there, but anyway.
You are out, Chris.
Yeah, fucking in reinventing the internet as single-handedly. Right, anyway, thank you everyone in chat for watching and putting up with our Witcher 3 ramblings, or my Witcher 3 ramblings. We are back, well, we're back every Wednesday at 7:30 GMT. We have a two-hour show for those of you who are new to the chat today. And that's pretty much it, 7:30 till 9:30.
Don't join us, GMT, please. It's BST at the moment.
Whatever. BST, then GMT. I'm sure it's still GMT classed as now.
Which summertime, BST. It's GMT plus one.
I don't believe you. I think it's the other way around. I think BST is GMT. Anyway, it doesn't matter. We're on now, and we'll be on next week, Wednesday, at roughly the same time. If you're interested in anything we do and you don't know our websites, it's www.resonancearcade.com. We're on youtube.com, Facebook and Twitter /resonancearcade. And Lou's website is somewhere else, so go and check that out.
My website?
Yep. All right. Love you all. Bye.